coming out and enjoying this evening with us. You know, without all of you taking interest in the PC Party in Ontario, none of us are going to be able to change anything in 4 years. And a huge thank you to the three leadership candidates as well, which I'll introduce here in a moment. Thank you to them. Their schedules are crazy busy, and they found time to come and share their thoughts and expressions with us here. You know, PC Party of Ontario has said, we have to get back to grassroots. I'll tell you, this is the epitome of what grassroots is. We get to come, we get to voice, we get to talk, we get to express. So please feel free, don't be shy. There's time afterwards as well. They will advise the format of tonight, so that will be coming shortly. There are a few people that we do want to introduce. Current sitting MPPs, Todd Smith from Hastings Prince Edward. Todd's here.
Way back here.
And Bob Bailey, I haven't seen Bob, but I want to make sure that he didn't sneak in. Great. We have three former MPPs with us this evening. MPP Gary Stewart, 1995-2003, Peterborough. Former MPP Steve Gilchrist, Scarborough Hillwood, 1995. We have MPP Rob Milligan from Northumberland-Quinte West. And it's kind of cool too. We know that there's a federal nomination process in place, and we have two candidates running federally as well that are here tonight. Mike Skinner from Peterborough. And Adam Morton from the new riding creative of Peterborough South. At this point, I'd like to introduce, as they don't need any introduction, so this is how sweet it is. It's going to be just name only. And just so you can recognize the boys from the girls. Christine Elliott.
The outline for the evening
is going to go something like this, and I didn't even notice. We're going to have opening remarks. There are about 3 minutes for each candidate, and then we're going to do some questions. We're going to start with a couple of questions that the riding associations have prepared, and then we're also going to go into the audience, and you'll have your opportunity to ask questions as well. Some of these questions will be directed to all three candidates, but each candidate will have their opportunity to answer the question, and we'll alternate those questions with questions that a single candidate will answer. These questions will be sourced from the audience by four lovely helpers. In the back, we've got Troy, who will wave, and we have Mark, who will wave. They both have mics at the back, and they'll come up through the audience when we get to that point. Scott and Dale Walker are also around to take your questions, so we'll be there to help you out. And with no further ado, we'll start with the first candidate opening questions, which will go to Monty.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Heather, and thank you all for being here tonight. I'd like to personally thank the organizers, Scott, Heather, the four ridings, for coming together. This is a very important point in history for our party as we select a new leader that's going to finally defeat Kathy Wynne and the Liberals in 2018. And amongst all the leadership candidates, we're committed to defeating the Liberals in 2018. So welcome tonight. I know we only have 3 minutes for an introduction. Of course, that's hard for politicians to keep any comments below 3 minutes, but I'll try to do my best. I represent the riding of Lent and Kent Middlesex. This is my second term serving as MPP at Queen's Park. My riding is the one between London, Chatham, and Sarnia. I'm married to my wife, Kate. We have a 19-month-old daughter, Annie. They were actually here in the beginning tonight, but ended up going to Peterborough to visit some friends. I think it'd be hard to keep our daughter content listening to politicians for the next hour and a half, so they went to visit some friends of ours. I come from a small business background. My family and I own a home hardware building center. Of course, I'm inside of a Canadian Tire building tonight, so a little bit of competition is good. I'm running for the leadership of our party because I don't want to see a second Liberal Party in the province of Ontario. I'm looking forward to outlining the platform that I'm running on. I'm talking about balancing the budget without raising taxes, scrapping the Liberals' ORPP pension scheme, ending wind turbines altogether in Ontario. And finally, I've taken a very strong stance against Kathleen Wynne's plan to bring in a new sex ed curriculum without talking to any parents. Two newspapers over the last few weeks taking on Kathleen Wynne's plan and taking on her sex ed agenda that, in my opinion, has no place in the classrooms in the province of Ontario. So I look forward to having that conversation with you tonight to talk in more detail about my plans for our party and about making a true conservative alternative in the next election, and look forward to your questions. Thank you very much.
Heather, and thank you everyone for coming tonight. It's great to see such a turnout. 3 minutes is brief, and good job, Monty, getting it all in. But I want to say, call spade a spade. Our party went into this leadership broken. The reality is we have 10,000 members. We are at a 50-year low of membership. We needed a drastic change. We needed a reset. You know, we lost an election that by all standards we should have won. We've been good at grasping defeat in the jaws of victory, and I'm tired of it. You know, I've had the honor of being in the federal parliament for the last 9 years, the last three terms. My background is as a lawyer and as a city councilor. Forgive me, I only practice law briefly, because I'm not affected by the practice. But on June 12th, I really looked at our party and said, what do we need to do to build it? Because I'm sick of seeing Liberals win elections. You know, we can talk and say, oh, they'll mess up again, and we'll get them next time. No, they've already been very good at Tesla. They've already been very good at mismanaging the economy, and we've lost because of ourselves. We can't have a top-down party. We can't have a party that doesn't value membership. We can't have a few people in the leadership of the party saying, we're going to run on this, and not ask you, The party needs to be defined by its membership. Our campaigns need to be driven by the energy of our membership. I think if we do that, we will run on ideas that reflect the concerns of our party, the concerns of the grassroots. And I think one of the wonderful things about this leadership is that we've built a party that now has people from every corner of the province, from every walk of life. You know, 10,000 members, we did not reflect Ontario. At 82,000, there is not a riding association in the province that does not have a strong membership. That's going to connect us from neighborhood to neighborhood. And the real work is going to begin on the 10th to make sure that we get it right. We get our party right, I think we can move mountains. I really do. The Liberals now have to cut a $12.5 billion deficit. And if you're a party of pragmatic ideas, if we are a party that says we want to make Ontario competitive again, and then right now, whether it's hydro prices, whether it's a broken education system, whether it's red tape, or whether it's the new things the Liberals want to do to make it worse, like this carbon tax and this job-killing pension scheme, if we are the party that says we want to make Ontario the easiest place to invest, a province that is free, a province that gets out of your way, you know, what a novel notion. We just want to get government out of your way so you can work hard and you can succeed. We do that, I think there's endless opportunity for our party. But it comes down to this. I was in Port Dover a few weeks ago, and I asked in the room, I said, what's your advice? How can we rebuild the PC party? And everyone gave their points. Then a 9-year-old boy put his hand up, and he said, the party needs to stop passing a puck in front of their own net. If a 9-year-old boy gets what's wrong, this is an opportunity for our party, for our membership, to take our party back. It cannot be the same old, same old. If you simply change the color of your paint and have all the same actors, all the same leadership running the show and saying, oh, we promise you, we'll listen this time, I'm not buying it. We have to get it right, and I'm excited for that journey.
Despite the inclement weather. For me, it's wonderful to be more or less in home territory, representing Whitby, Oshawa, as I do, after all the traveling that we've been doing over the last, I guess, almost 9 months now. But wherever I've gone and traveled across the province, what I've heard universally from everyone is, we have to win the next election. We have to win in 2018. It can't be 2022. It has to be 2018. And it's not just because we want to win the election as PCs after four successive election losses. If Ontario needs us to win the next election. Take a look at what the Liberals have done to this province in the last 12 years. We're mired in debt. We've got more up to $325 billion in debt by 2018. It's unbelievable to even contemplate that much money. And you know, Kathleen Wynne and the Liberals like to think that they're the ones who are the compassionate ones. They're the ones that care. They're the ones that want to create the just society. But leaving our children and grandchildren with $325 billion of debt that will rob them of the opportunity to have the same choices in life and standard of living that we've enjoyed is not compassionate. To me, that's morally bankrupt, and we need to change that. So we all agree on that. The question is how? How do we change things? How do we win after losing four times in a row? To me, it's pretty simple. We need to change the tone and direction of our party, because a lot of people are not listening to us. We still have a huge gender gap. A lot of women aren't voting for us. A lot of young people don't even think we're relevant. And it's pretty tough to be a PC member on campus associations these days. I really admire the courage and tenacity, but we need to give them the tools they need to demonstrate what we're really about. Similarly with new Canadians, a lot of them have not heard our message of what it is to truly be a progressive conservative. So we need to talk about that. And to me, we need to go back to the roots of our party, what our party is really all about. And to me, they're twofold. One is we're fiscally responsible. We're not liberals. We don't spend money that we don't have. We spend within our means, and we spend the money that we do have on priorities. Because we all know that government should not try to be all things to all people. There are many things that individuals and families and communities can do together that don't involve government. But what we haven't talked about, that's that part of the message I think people understand, but what we haven't talked about is why that's important. It's important so that we can be socially compassionate. It's important so that we can protect the healthcare services and education services that are so children with autism, mental health problems, and other special needs. We need to be able to help our frail elderly seniors get the home care and long-term care services they work for all their lives. And to me, for those of you who know my beloved Ability Center, we need to celebrate everyone's abilities and give everyone in Ontario an opportunity to be successful, because everyone has abilities and we need to celebrate them. That's what my Ontario looks like. Those are the values that I grew up with in a very proud, progressive, conservative family. That you work hard, you take care of your family, but you contribute to your community, you volunteer, and you take care of those people who need our help. And I can tell you, as I'm taking that message across the province, it's resonating with people. And not just with our PC members. It's with people who parked their vote with the Liberals last time by default, because we did not provide the credible alternative that people were looking for. So we need to change that. We need to get out there and talk about our positive message, and I know that's how we're going to win the next election in 2018. But of course we can't do it alone. You're all members, you're all volunteers. I know you've all worked on campaigns. We need to respect our members and make sure all of you are involved in decision making as we go forward, especially as it relates to policy. I'm firmly committed to doing that should I have the honor of becoming your leader. And so I think this is the start of many conversations. I look forward to our discussion tonight. Thank you very much. Haliburton-Kawartha Lakes-Brock particularly are very familiar with those issues. So we need to make sure that we do it in a smart way and where it makes sense and not just a desperate cash grab. As far as the privatization of the LCBO is concerned, I think that is a controversial issue. There's a lot of opinions on it. And again, I want to make sure that we work with our members to make sure that we develop coherent policy and not make decisions one off with a small group of people. We're all in this together. We're all part of the same team. And we need to make those decisions as a group.
Great. Well, excellent question. And yeah, I think you can clock it out. Excellent question. Look, I think government is lousy at running businesses, to be quite frank. History demonstrates under all three parties, a lot of times, especially in the electricity system, that's where political parties appoint people for patronage appointments. I think if you just look at power generation in Durham or Hydro One, there's something like 18,000 people, it might even be higher, earning over $100,000 per year. We all know the story of a former CEO who was fired, but got something like a $2 million severance working in one of the hydro systems. That's why, as Premier of Ontario and as leader of our party, I would advocate for private sector involvement in the electricity system in particular. I think that's the biggest need right now in the province. I agree with Patrick and Christine when it comes to the LCBO and other Crown corporations. We need to have a debate as a party, but when it comes to the electricity system, we're desperate for private sector discipline. We cannot continue with the abuse and mismanagement that we're seeing across all the electricity system in Ontario. Thanks.
Got a question, to put your hand up, just a signal, sort of somebody in the room. I know Scott's looking and the three people at the back as well. So if you do have a question, I have one more question I'm going to ask Christine, just as a spoiler, but then we're going to need somebody from the crowd to ask a question. Thank you. So the next question is yours, Christine. What are your ideas for increasing the number of young Ontarians in our Ontario PC Party?
Thank you, because that is a really significant issue because we don't have a lot of young people that are attracted to our party right now. They don't see us as being relevant. We're not talking about issues that really are important to them. So I think that one of the things that we've all been doing as part of this process is really trying to engage young people, visiting campus associations, making sure our young people are involved in decision making, and really bring people to the table, not in the sense of, as we usually do, is take our young members for granted and have them wear the t-shirts and wave the flag around election time. What I think we need to do is continue visiting campus associations, helping them to raise money, to be able to be involved in events like our conventions and so on, to help them go out and spread the word. So there's a lot of things we can do with the youth organizations that are already existing, but I also think they need to be at the table for policy making. We need to bring them involved and get them involved in a very real way. One of my ideas for consideration is to have a council elected at our next annual general meeting where we would have regional representatives elected and specifically youth representatives who would receive policy ideas from PACs, from individuals, from riding associations, and be able to vet those policy ideas from a 360-degree perspective so that they can raise the red flag if those policy ideas don't make sense or, if they do, green light them to go on to our policy conventions to make sure that we get fulsome policy from all parts of the party. So young people, we need to help them have the tools they need in turn to go out and speak to other young people, but we really need to have them at the table in a real way to discuss those issues so that we can deal with them. We know that youth unemployment is a huge issue, but there are many other things that we haven't heard about because we haven't had them at the table. Thank you.
We have a question for Patrick Brown. Our chair is Les Bridge from Portland, Haliburton-Kawartha, and Les on the rest.
Thank you. Mr. Brown, I heard your commitment about building the party. We build the party from the ground up, and I agree with you 100%. I think that's an essential thing to do. My question, though, and only you can answer this one, is how do you square that commitment to the party with your decision not to vacate your federal nomination? Doesn't that kind of contradict that? How can we be convinced of your strong commitment to the Ontario PC Party?
Sure, thank you for the question. And I have said that, first of all, I intend to win this leadership and run provincially. But if for some reason that did not happen and the new leader wanted me to run provincially, I would unequivocally be proud to run provincially. I've been a member of this party for 22 years, and regardless of what happens as leadership, I will be eager to serve in any capacity I can. And I can tell you there have been a number of occasions before when we've had members outside the caucus run for leaderships. The Prime Minister himself has been outside the caucus on the evening. You saw that with Brian Rooney, and more recently with Jim Prentice. And certainly everything I've done making sure that I heeded the advice of the Prime Minister first, and I appreciate your question.
The next question will be started. Monty will ask the next question. And because we bounced out, we're going to bounce sort of around you again, Patrick, okay, just to keep things in sort of some sort of order. So just so you're aware of that. We have another question. This particular one will go to everyone. So we'll start with Monty, and then Patrick will answer, and then Christine will answer.
My name is Jack Polkinghorn. I'm from the Peterborough area. And I love to win as a BC, and I hate my hell to lose. And we've lost a bit. I was told that the swearing in for Maurice Scott at $2,000 by the president of the BC Party of Ontario, that in fact he was going to make sure that we were going to have rural input in how to run a political campaign. We obviously didn't have it. I don't think anybody down there had been north of Highway number 7. My question is, are you, as a leader, going to make sure that we have the rights of all the people in Ontario to have input into how to run a political campaign? The Toronto guys bracket there, they know how to do it, and they haven't won in Toronto even. So what is your policy as far as what we're going to do to get organized for the next campaign and not lose it?
Great side. That as candidates right across the province. I actually kicked off this campaign. My wife, daughter, and I loaded up our Dodge minivan, and we set out to visit every single riding, all 107 of them, in 66 days. And I did that because I wanted to reach out to the grassroots to hear what they were saying, what they were feeling, and that's the common comment that the majority of the people said. Look, we have to clean house within the party. It's no different than any organization where the sales are slipping, the results aren't there, you've got a clean house at the top. That's what I intend to do. After that 107 riding tour, I put out, after listening to the members and doing an online survey, a party reform piece called Members First. And I want to highlight three things that I would do as party leader to turn the party back over to every single person who spends $10 a year to have that party membership. Number one, I want all party members approving the next platform. So every single party member will have a chance to vote on the next policy platform, idea by idea. Secondly, there needs to be more accountability by the leader and by the leader's office to the members. After every single election, I propose that every party member will have a chance to approve my leadership. If you want me to stay, great. If I deserve to go, you'll vote for me to be gone. I think that will improve the accountability by the leader. Lastly, we have to end this one-size-fits-all type of policy platform that our party's had for 20 years. I want regional and local issues to be part of that party platform. The example that I always use, Tim Goodak in the last campaign went to Ottawa, I think he announced a big corporate tax cut that didn't resonate with the voters across Ontario. All the media that were there wanted to know how was our party going to pay for the LRT transportation system in Ottawa, but we didn't have a solution to that. And I think we have to have local and regional issues, whether, you know, in this area it's Kawartha Downs or the nuclear plant here, issues that speak to the local community. And I think by listening to the members, by having party members approve the platform, we can overcome the problems that we've had in the last 20 years. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. I think the question was specific to rural Ontario and how we're going to make sure that voice is heard. On this leadership campaign, I'm very privileged to have the support of the Ontario Landowners Association. I think they've been a voice for rural Ontario in a very powerful fashion. I know MPP Jack McLaren has been very active on my campaign. Just recently this week, the Ontario Farmers Magazine endorsed my candidacy as well. I believe that obviously as the As a party, we need to make sure we stand up for rural communities, and I intend to make sure that our platform speaks to those concerns, because if there's one thing where I think all of you with the Liberals is that they have had no interest in representing rural Ontario, and it's our job as the Progressive Conservatives to make sure we give a strong voice to that, and we don't shun from the side. Obviously, in our platforms in the past, I don't think we've given adequate voice to those concerns. And one thing I've heard here locally from some of the rural areas close to here, that the wind turbines are an utter disaster. This hydro policy has made us uncompetitive. It's not just a quality of life issue, but it's a job killer. And I understand the Sumac Ridge development is now going ahead, so you're going to get more of these wind turbines. And I'd say, I would not be applauding wind turbines, but I would agree to disagree. I want to be a PC party that says, we should be there opposing. We should be saying that is a broken, unmitigated disaster. And we as Progressive Conservatives will stand up for rural Ontario and say, you know what, if Kathleen wants to do that, she can do it in her ride.
Did not listen to rural voices. We need to understand the concerns. We did have decisions that were being made in a vacuum by a group of people in Toronto, pretty much by people who I don't think ever knocked on the door. They did want to come up with some of the policies we've run on in the last couple of election campaigns. So we need to make sure that we continue listening to those voices. I think part of my previous answers sort of answers this question, that we need to make sure that we have a group that's there on a regular basis that represents all parts of Ontario, including rural voices, to talk about what the issues are and the needs are, and make sure that the policies we develop are going to make sense around the province. Certainly, I found in my travels on this campaign, especially in, I would say, northern Ontario, we had some policies there that not only were not helpful, they were actually counterproductive. They were very, very harmful to us, and we've got to stop doing that. So we need to have that mechanism within the party so that we can have that regular review of policies. But I think it's also incumbent on the leader to continue to travel. In the same way, the party started consultations after the last election to meet with members on a regional basis and not expect members to come to $500 a plate fundraisers to be able to speak with whoever the leader of the party is. We need to make sure that we engage regularly with the members of our party to hear your concerns and the issues that are important in your community, so that as we craft our policies for the next election campaign, we're going to make decisions that are going to make sense across the province. And, you know, we need to listen to rural voices, but we also need to win in cities, too. And to me, they're not mutually exclusive. The rural solutions may vary, but I think it's fair to say that a lot of issues that are concerns in rural Ontario, especially healthcare, education issues, hydro, energy issues, they're concerns to people across the province. We have to find local solutions, but we need to make sure everybody's involved in the decision making to come to conclusions and policies that can make sense across the province, because that's the only way we're going to win.
Now, because we're a little out of order, the next question actually goes to Christine. What standard guides you in your decision making?
I would say the standard is, what do we stand for as Progressive Conservatives? I think we need to take a look at what are the values that we stand for? What do we all believe in collectively? What does it mean to be a Progressive Conservative? And I think I answered some of that in my opening remarks, that we need to be fiscally responsible because we can't do anything else without doing that. But we also need to be socially compassionate. Really look at it through that lens. Is it going to help Ontario? Is it going to help us to grow our economy? Is it going to help us to make sure that Ontario becomes first again in Canada? It's a shame what's happened to our province. We need to take a look at that and make decisions based on what's good for the people of Ontario, what's good for our economy, and not do what the Liberals do, is make decisions based on political expediency and what's going to allow them to get their member elected in the next election. We need to look at the good of all the people across the province, make decisions based on evidence, make decisions based on the values that we all share as Progressive Conservatives, but making sure that we are all involved in that decision making, because it's not just me that would be able to make those decisions. I know that I don't know everything. My sons tell me that on a regular basis. But I think that we have a wealth of experience and knowledge in our party that we need to bring to the fore so that we have all the information that we need in order to make good decisions and we make them collectively together.
We do indeed. We have Anita DeVries from Durham Region. Anita would like to ask a question about the Interior College of Trades.
Hello, candidates. It's nice to see you all. I'm Anita DeVries. I'm the Executive Officer of Durham Region Home Builders Association. And in the last election, Tim Hudak, we strongly supported in his opinion that was to abolish the Ontario College of Trades. It causes a lot of problems for trades. Then it was newly created. Now, in the next election, it will have been in place for a little while. Right now, there's a review going on with the Tony Deans running that meeting. So I'm just wondering, as a leader, Christine, what will your direction be now in regards to the Ontario College of Trades and the problems our trades people are experiencing because of it?
This will actually go on
a
rotation, so it'll be Monte.
Well, a great question. Look, you're coming from a small business background. I certainly believe fundamentally that government has to get out of the way of business and entrepreneurship and the free market. We had the correct position in the last campaign. I'm interested now in, number one, hearing what party members think, because you're right, this is going to be in place for 4 years before the next election, essentially. There is this, they're looking at it to possibly come up with recommendations and reform the College of Trade. So I would wait to see what those recommendations are first. But as leader and as a small business person, I can tell you that I will do whatever is necessary to get red tape out of the way of our business people in the province, because it's costing us jobs, it's making Ontario uncompetitive, but specifically with the College of Trades, I'm going to wait to see what the report says this fall.
Sure, and I agree with the approach that Monty has taken. I applaud him for that. I think it's important to listen. It's important to see what the party feels after this last election, and obviously hearing stories about hairdressers being put into the College of Trades, which makes many people question its value, but I'd say it's important to look at the report. But let's not jump to conclusions before we see what the reform suggestions are. And I have a bunch of stakeholders who have different ideas around the College of Trades, from UNA to those that are involved in apprentices today. So my advice is, let's actually wait, let's provide thoughtful analysis, and let's see what that report says. I think our party has had has made errors in the past by jumping to conclusions too quickly. The last budget, when it was presented, we announced that we were against it before we even read it. And I think a lot of Ontarians felt that sent the wrong message, that we weren't open-minded, we weren't authentic in terms of trying to hear all different perspectives. And I think right now we do have the benefit of 3 years before the next election. And there'll be an opportunity to actually do some real engagement of our membership, some real engagement of stakeholders. And I think there's a lot of interest in how you can make the College of Trades more effective, whether that's reform or abolishment. I think we'd be remiss if we made that announcement today.
But there's no question there's significant problems with that at this point.
question's from Ted Stillman from Northumberland-Quinte West.
The Energy Review Board seems to just rubber stamp anything hydro asks for or delivery rates, and same way with the natural gas. Did they ever turn them down? And I know a lot of people in the rural area, they pay more in delivery charge than the actual electricity they use. And I was just wondering, while you still own hydro, or parts of it, and control parts of it, what can you do to straighten some of that out? And the debt retirement charge, somebody's, I believe, is messing with the with their figures, because it was paid off in 2013, and then McGinty extended until 2017. So I just wonder what each of you would do to
Well, I think your characterization is bang on that it's a mess. I think the one file the Liberals have mismanaged, it's definitely hydro. You know, I think you outlined some of the concerns in your question. I think we need to have a complete review of our energy policy. I think we actually have to have a plan going forward, because it's not sustainable. I was visiting high-tech greenhouse farm plant in Leamington, Ontario, getting a tour, and the owner of the plant told me that he's going to double in size from 300 employees to 600. I said, fantastic. Then he told me he was doing it in the U.S. I said, why? And he said, 14 cents a kilowatt in Leamington, 5 cents south of the border. Those are jobs we're not getting provincial income revenue on. Those are jobs that we've lost that are going to hurt that community. And you know, that's happening around Ontario. Now, I want to make sure that we have hydro policy that's competitive with comparative jurisdictions. You know, the fact is, if you look at the comparative jurisdictions to Ontario, we're not competitive. You know, I had a fundraiser last month with Jean Charest, the former premier of Quebec, and I gave my speech, and afterwards he said, you know, those companies that were pushing the Green Energy Act, they pitched it to Quebec too. He said, we're surprised when the MT went for it. We're surprised he got hoodwinked. It made me think, you know, other provinces didn't jump to this. It was Ontario that got hoodwinked. It was Dalton McGuinty that allowed ourselves to get hoodwinked. And they still don't get it. In November, they issued an RFP for another $1 billion and more of these wind turbines, despite the fact we have a massive oversupply. So we need a complete review, and at the very starting point, we need to rip up this Green Energy Act, and I appreciate the question.
To build their skills, to graduate with a degree or diploma,
and a business idea. So we need to get rid of the red tape, help them to create those business opportunities. We need to look at how we can help them to finance them. That's a big problem. We've got great ideas, we've got great research happening here in Ontario, but when it comes time to commercialize those ideas, bring them to market and create those jobs, we don't have the capital there. Because the banks won't lend money to new university graduates, as you probably know, for untested business ideas. So we need to empower them and create those small and medium-sized enterprises as well as bringing back manufacturing. But the small and medium-sized enterprises are the backbone of our economy, and we need to put the conditions in place to allow them to be able to thrive. And finally, my fourth point for your consideration is to make smart investments in infrastructure. In infrastructure both in cities, it's going to mean transit, roads and so on, transit systems. In more rural areas, it's going to be building roads, bridges, and the other infrastructure that you need in order to be able to move goods and people. We need to start making those investments based on what's going to be good for our economy, and not, as Liberals traditionally do, on the basis of what's going to allow that member to be elected in a particular riding. So that's the basis of the economic plan that I would be putting forward, with your approval, of course. I think there's many, many more ideas that we can generate together. This is just a starting point.
Thanks, Paula. Excellent question. I think first and foremost, we have to have a breaker in Ontario that is going to go in into that office with the attitude of making Ontario the number one jurisdiction in North America to do business, to expand their business, and create that environment for businesses to come. I think first and foremost, as a party and as a conservative government, we've got to get the fiscal house in order. There's not a company in the world that wants to come to a province that's as mismanaged as Ontario is right now. We have four OPP investigations going on into this government. That turns companies off. We have a $300 billion debt in Ontario. That turns investors off. If you consider we have a $300 billion debt this year, but 10 years ago, it was about $120 billion. That sends a bad signal to investors in North America and around the world. So first and foremost, we've got to get the fiscal house in order. We have a government payroll that's unsustainable. There is a report that came out yesterday saying that public sector employees are paid way more than people in the private sector. As conservatives, we've got to be the voice to talk about issues like that, to get the fiscal house in order, to get government payrolls down. We have one out of every 10 people in the province working for taxpayers. It's unsustainable, and these are issues I think 4 years from now, in 2018, or 3 years from now, in 2018, that we're going to have to deal with, and we're going to have to put forward a plan that people understand, that people accept. And I can guarantee you, if we get the fiscal house in order, bring a good government back to Ontario, get out of the way of investors and job creators, we can make Ontario the number one jurisdiction in all of North America again. Thanks.
Make Ontario a destination for investment. Reminds me of a story when I was visiting Gujarat in Western India. I had the privilege of being chair of the Canada India Parliamentary Association for 9 years, and in 2009 I was visiting a state that had gone from being the weakest in India to the strongest. I asked the chief minister, how did you make your state so successful? And here we are 6 years later, and his response stuck with me. He said, you need good roads to get product to marketplace, you need cheap power, and you need to cut red tape. Now compare that to Ontario. We've got gridlock suffocating our urban hubs. We have the most expensive power in North America, and we are a haven for red tape. So I would build the roads to get product to marketplace. I would make our hydro rates competitive, and a starting point for bringing up the Green Energy Act. And I would cut red tape. Now, Steve Gilchrist is here. Steve, when you were in office provincially, you had a red tape reduction secretary. You cut red tape. In Ottawa, I was proud to vote for Tony Clement's motion that said, for every new regulation government passes, we'll delete an existing one. So red tape does not grow under Stephen Harper. That hasn't been the case under Kathleen Wynne. We have 364,000 regulations on the books in Ontario with an estimated application cost of $11 billion a year. We're not a good place to invest. We need to change that. And liberals are making it worse. The job and the pension scheme, the carbon tax are going to make it more difficult for Ontario to be a choice. And that's why we're being poached. I hear about businesses in New York and Michigan going across the border and saying, come over. It's cheaper. We are losing jobs. No wonder we've lost 300,000 manufacturing jobs. I'd also say this. I believe education has a component in creating a successful economy. You know, right now, the only thing liberals seem focused on is grade one sex education. And I'd say, you know, just focus on reading, writing, and mathematics. You know, if we could add anything at high school, let's add financial literacy. Maybe the liberals don't want to teach kids how to balance budgets, but at the very least, we can. But more fundamentally, I look at the education system today, we're graduating people for jobs that existed 10 and 15 years ago. You know, not the jobs of today and tomorrow. And the education system has to be linked to market conditions, has to be linked to the economy. Last year, we graduated 9,000 teachers for 5,000 new teaching positions. We were subsidizing diplomas for jobs that don't exist. And conversely, I was up in Sudbury, at Cambrian College, 24 graduates of the Powerline program, 300 jobs. There was a report that suggests we lose $3.7 billion a year for jobs not filled. You know, I look at Germany and I look at the Nordic countries, an education system tailored towards employment, and they have rich manufacturing sectors. Let's build an education system that takes into context the jobs that actually exist.
As a party, how do you propose we approach the areas of education and healthcare in this province by continuing to invest, but at the same time being fiscally responsible with tax dollars?
They're a good question. I mean, we're often asked, you know, about investing in frontline healthcare services and more EAs in the classroom. I fundamentally believe that we have to, I mean, similar to my last answer, but we have to get the fiscal house in order in Ontario in order so that we can invest in the important services that we value as people here in Ontario. But specifically with education and healthcare, I know it's the same with the hospitals here, specifically with healthcare anyways. We see that, you know, the administration, the bureaucracy seems to grow, but yet we have fewer nurses, or in education we have fewer EAs in the classroom. I think that's the problem in Ontario. We create, or the Liberals have created in the last 10 years, these bureaucratic bodies like the LIDs, the Local Health Integration Networks, the CCACs. These things are sucking hundreds of millions of dollars per year out of the healthcare system in Ontario. That money should be used to invest in the frontline services. In my riding of Lambton County, Middlesex, we have three rural hospitals. I walk into those hospitals. Secretaries have secretaries today in our hospitals. It's wrong. We need to get that money to the frontline services and to the front lines where that money belongs. After the 2011 election, I think the best story that highlights this for me, in 2011, after I was elected, the former CEO of London Health Sciences Center got a retention bonus. So this gentleman was making almost $1 million a year. The board of directors passed a motion and approved it to give him a retention bonus of $1.25 million to keep him in London. But it also came out that they bought him a Lexus car. They paid for his financial advisor. And in the same story, it came out that this gentleman now had 49 vice presidents, all making $100,000 a year under him. Folks, that's what's wrong with the healthcare system in Ontario. That's what's happening with the Liberals. As a conservative government, we've got a clean house starting at the top.
It'll
be answered by all three candidates and start with Patrick. And I believe
you've got a question. So our question comes from Darcy McGee, who's from Haliburton-Kawartha Lakes-Brock. And Darcy would like to know how each of the candidates is going to win our seats in the urban areas and failed to put it through.
And thank you all for putting your names forward and having the courage to run for our party leadership. So I have had the honor of chairing the Prime Minister's GTA caucus, and in that capacity I have lived and breathed urban challenges on behalf of a federal party. The reality is, it was one of the most significant reasons why we lost the last election. We got wiped out for the most part, with a few exceptions in urban Ontario. And you know, I look at the city of Toronto in particular. 52% of the city was born outside of Canada. You know, I know with the federal party, we live and breathe cultural engagement. For the last 9 years, I've been one of the guest speakers for the Canadian Foundation, ICCC Gala, the Knights of Brazil Filipino Party, the Tamil Starfest in Markham. And it's once in a blue moon that I see a provincial conservative. The federal party has made it a point of showing up religiously. Now, we have a conference call every week to make sure that every one of the 100 events that might be happening in the GTA that weekend, we're there. If you build a relationship, most of these communities share conservative values, but you have to show up. So that's one point. We're going to show up and make sure that never again do we leave those fields uncontested to the liberals. One of the reasons my membership drive was so successful in areas where the party was essentially defunct was that we engaged cultural communities. You look at some of the websites, Gujaratis for Patrick or Tamils for Patrick, and we signed up members in communities that we are not involved in our party. The second thing I would say about urban politics and about the GTA, let's take a lesson from the last Toronto election. Both John Tory and Doug Ford were conservatives and they ran on transit. You know, Doug Ford said, subway, subway, subway. John Tory said, smart track, smart track, smart track. But it highlighted the fact that one frustration in the GTA, one frustration in Toronto is gridlock. It is congestion, it's traffic. And I think there's an opportunity for a conservative party that speaks with a credible position on how to move people. And the fact that you can have two conservatives in John Tory and Doug Ford, whatever you think of them, but they both recognize that. I would love to be the leader of our party that shows up in Toronto at every cultural function, building relationships with a platform that speaks in an exciting way to transit.
Downtown, as I do, it takes 2 hours one way to drive to Queen's Park. And the reality is, I'm not even going to take public transit every day. So we need to come up with some solutions that are going to make sense in urban areas. Transit and transportation are going to be two of the most major issues, but I think that other issues are going to be important because people are concerned about the same things whether they live in rural areas or urban areas. The solutions, blueberry, healthcare. I've been health critic for the party for the last almost 5 years now, and I can tell you there are major issues in healthcare out there right now. Home care, long-term care. Peterborough has an older population, huge long-term care issues that we need to deal with. We need to come up with solutions that are going to work for Peterborough, Haliburton-Kawartha Lakes-Brock, Northumberland, and Durham ridings. And all of those can be considered, but the regional solutions will vary. So we need to come up with good, solid public policy addressing the gridlock issue. That's probably the most major issue, but there are many others. And we need to reinvigorate our policy advisory committees to get people from all parts of our party to come together with their expertise and knowledge to offer solutions. We really didn't have a very robust urban issues policy in our last campaign. We need to develop that policy in order to be able to win both in rural and in urban issues. On the issue of outreach, I would say, Todd Smith may disagree with you a little bit, Patrick, on what we're doing in terms of outreach. Todd has been working very hard on outreach for the last couple of years, building those relationships with Canadians. There's no question that we have a lot more work that we need to do. We haven't been as successful yet as our federal counterparts, but I would say one of the things that we need to do as a provincial party is to make sure we address the proper resources to allow those outreach efforts to continue. Because we've got caucus members who are ready, willing, and able to continue that outreach, but we need to make sure they have the resources to be able to advertise in newspapers in different communities, to be able to go to events, to be able to have that kind of presence. That's what I would certainly want to do as a leader, to make sure that we reach out to those with new communities, new Canadians, who haven't heard our message about what it is to be progressive conservative, and that's a winning combination. So we need to address those issues of new people coming into our party, new people coming into our urban communities. But a lot of the other issues, I think, are remaining the same, whether you're rural or urban. We need to find solutions that are going to work for everybody around the province.
We're never going to form government if we don't win in urban Ontario. I agree with what Patrick and Christine said as far as transportation issues, but I want to address something else that I touched on in my opening statement. If we're going to win new Canadians over specifically, if we're going to win in suburban Ontario, we can't be afraid as conservatives to talk about conservative values. And I'm talking about standing on the side of moms and dads out there. There's nothing that angers new Canadians more than Kathleen Wynne trying to bring in her sex ed agenda and forcing that on parents and their children. I've stood shoulder to shoulder in the last 14 days with 5,000 new Canadians in the GTA, across the GTA, in protest against the sex ed agenda. I'm not saying that I come to this issue first and foremost as a father. Secondly, I believe that parents should be first educators on serious issues like sex education. And thirdly, and most importantly, it's not the government's job, it's not the premier's job, especially this premier with all the scandals going on, to tell me as a father, my wife as a mother, or any parent in Ontario what's age appropriate for their child. That's what I'm trying to say. Have to win the support of new Canadians. We're going to win the support of new Canadians if we stand up for their values. And this, to me, is an easy one. As a party, all of us should be standing up against Kathleen Wynne's plan to bring in a sex ed agenda starting at 5 years of age.
Okay, the next question is from Brian Callery from Port Perry.
Quite all right. I would, I'd be much more comfortable talking about money and insurance and business because that's what I do. However, it's a very complex question, but Mr. McNaughton, it does address your issue. I'm from a large Irish Catholic family, so you can imagine the sex educational issue is an item with us, and I'm a male. Who happens to have two beautiful daughters, and thank God a smarter wife than I am. It's a very difficult issue addressing sex education with youngsters, especially the males in this room having discussions with their kids. I don't know if I'm qualified to handle a lot of these things. From the standpoint of we as parents, trying to have these discussions from a standpoint of our morality, from the standpoint of our whole culture, Do you not think that we have to address some of the basic issues? Because we're going to find out about these things anyway. It's no secret that as we grew up, we didn't have a great sex education issue, and all we learned it was God knows. And we certainly don't want the back of the Dodge. You know what I mean? So all I'm saying is how this is a very difficult question, as much as you're talking about money. But at the end of the day, it's very relevant to our society, very relevant to the kids, and especially with single family issues. Where do the kids learn properly how to ask proper questions and learn morality? It has to be part of the education system as well, because churches aren't exactly full on Sundays either.
And the question
is, how do we address this in an appropriate manner? Because we have to address it.
Thank you, sir. And the question actually was to Christine.
Thank you very much for the question, Brian. It's great to see you. It is a very difficult question. And I think that the Liberals started off really on a very bad way by not adequately consulting our parents on this issue. It was they addressed the issue with a few, not small, select group of parents, but there wasn't the kind of broad consultation didn't expect it on something like this. I think that, there's no question you have to have a sex education program in schools, because there's, and it needs to be updated, because let's face it, the things have changed since it was last updated. We've got sexting, we've got harassment, we've got all this online stuff that's going on right now. But what I've heard from a lot of parents is what they're mostly concerned about is age appropriateness, when children are learning things. And the concern is that a lot of children are learning things that at an age that's too young, at an age when children really aren't asking those questions. And if we've learned anything, and what I've learned as a parent, even though my son probably doesn't want to even talk about that, is that you have to wait until they start asking questions to know, to gauge what they really want to know about. And so what I would want to do is to continue to listen to parents and listen to their concerns about what is age appropriate and make sure that we get this right, because I do believe that parents are the ones that should be able to make these choices for the children. They are the ones that know their children best. They know what's age appropriate for them, and we need to continue to listen to them.
Thanks. Just with time in mind, this is actually going to be our last question. It will go to all three. We will start with Monty, and then we'll do closing remarks after that. So the final question of the night is, please detail your plan for your first 100 days of the year.
Well, I haven't asked this one yet before, but I think that's a tremendous question. You know, first and foremost, I've always said that I want our platform announced well in advance of the next election. I believe that we should be announcing policy platforms, you know, mid-campaign. We all know the one that was announced mid-campaign that didn't go over so well this time. So I want it out a long time in advance. Then we're ready to hit the road running day one of our government. So first and foremost, I'm going to announce that I would scrap the Liberals' ORPP pension scheme. So anyone making, for those of you that don't know, anyone making $45,000 per year is going to have to contribute $800 to the Liberals. The employer has to match that. So that's $1,600 out of the economy for someone making $45,000 per year. That would be gone on day one, because there actually is only a short window to reveal that and refund all the money back to individuals and businesses. Secondly, I would move quickly to end wind turbines in the province of Ontario. We have to stop immediately the contracts are going forward. This is something that is going to cost $60 billion over the next 20 years for power that we don't even need in Ontario. We're dumping this excess electricity into the states at a massive discount. We can't afford it. It has to be stopped immediately. Third, I would move right away to evaluate every single government program in Ontario to ensure that it's value for money. If a program isn't delivering value for taxpayers, it's gone. We've got to make some very, very tough decisions as a conservative government, because we cannot afford to spend $12.5 billion more per year than we're taking in every single year. Lastly, I would move, again on the fiscal side, to, at a minimum, flatline spending. It's interesting, if the Liberals would have only froze spending in 2012, we would have had a balanced budget in Ontario this year. But unfortunately, they continue to spend billions and billions of dollars extra each additional year. That's why we're in this mess that we're in today. So I would not be afraid to make those tough decisions. I think that's what taxpayers want. That's what ratepayers need. That's how we're going to turn Ontario around.
We started the process during the leadership, but I said earlier today, it really starts May 10th. We have to make sure that everyone who joined during this leadership sees value in their membership. There are lots of regions in this province where they felt the party has given up. The party does not care. The first thing I would do as leader of the party is after meeting with caucus and those on the party executive and youth executive, is I would go out to every corner of the province that doesn't feel engaged in our party and continue to build. You know, when I went to Northern Ontario, people told me, oh, the party doesn't care about Northern Ontario because they didn't even come to the Northern Leaders debate. You only see them once a year if they're lucky. I would go to the corners of Northern Ontario where the party does not feel that they count. I would go to the corners of this province, whether it is Windsor or whether it is the heart of Scarborough, where our party has not had a significant presence, and I would continue the work that I've started in this leadership by making sure that everyone is engaged and they know we're going after those seats. We're going after those areas of the province where the party has not run hard. I'd also start the process of building a process for policy consultation. In a day and age where it's never been easier to communicate, whether it's teletown halls, through the internet, through regional policy consultations, we don't. You know, so one premise I have, one value I have as party leader is this. You know, I had a supporter in Mississauga, your dad, Gil, who told me when I came into his living room, he said, "Patrick, remember this on May 10th if you win." He said, "God gave you 2 ears and one mouth. Listen. The Ontario PC Party needs to listen. I will go and listen to our party memberships. I will listen to what causes our party to tick. I will go around the province and meet with stakeholders. Because one thing I've heard again and again is that we have a lot to work to do when we carry those relationships. Whether it is police associations, fire associations, nurses associations, paramedics, I've been told again and again that we had a closed door. We're going to have an open door. We're going to build. We're going to listen. And we're going to make sure that the party that was 10,000 in July, that has grown to 82,000, is going to continue to grow. I made a promise at the beginning of this leadership that we would build a party of 100,000, a party that listens, and a party that is driven by the ideas and the energy of our membership. And that project starts day one.
Moving on all cylinders. There's not any one single thing. We need to move on a number of fronts simultaneously, both internally to our party as well as externally. Internally, there's no question we need to pull the party back together again to make sure that we respect the voices of all members of the party and to continue the kind of outreach that was started by the party executive after the last election by continuing to have regional meetings with members to get the policy advisory committees back up and running and give them a real mandate, not just pay lip service to let's have these PACs out there and come up with ideas, empower them to come forward with policy ideas and put them into that committee that I talked about earlier to allow them to start analyzing policy ideas that are going to make sense for a platform in 2018. We need to start the work on that, and I do agree with Monty that I am very much in favor of what we did in 1984 with the Common Sense Revolution, getting those ideas out there in a policy document, a platform document, well in advance of the next election because we really don't have any time to lose. And a 30-day election period really doesn't give us enough time to fully articulate what our plan is going to be. So we really need to re-engage with our members, get everyone thinking about policy. We need to do a lot of fundraising too, let's face it. We've got a big fiscal hole. We've still got several million dollars in debt we've got to pay off. But we have to engage people in order to do that. We have to have a vision of a plan that is appealing to people, to get people to want to come on board with us to be able to eradicate that debt, build up our membership, and get ready for the next election. With local riding associations, we need to help them. We can't keep going back to local riding associations, especially where they're non-member held, and say, 6 months before our election, how's it going? I didn't raise all the money. That doesn't work. We need to look at all 107 ridings, not take any one of them off the table because we need to be competitive in all of those ridings, but we need to help them. We need to help them financially. We need to help them build up their human resources. We need to help the candidate and the association to be ready to fight and win the next election. That's all internal, but I think we also need to start looking at how we're going to get organized in what we're going to do as after we win the next election in 2018. And what I talked about in my draft economic plan subject to your approval is making sure that should I become the leader after May 10th, I would want to sit down and talk, get convene a panel of experts to talk about it, comprised of a lot of our members, because everywhere I've gone, I've had people volunteering to serve on these committees, to take a look at how do we develop that coherent energy policy that's going to be so important for us economically, as well as for residential consumers going forward. We need to be able to have a coherent plan in place so that when we win the next election, we can hit the ground running, we'll be able to implement it, and not say, well, we'd like to do this, but we need to convene this expert panel. We need to start now, working on those things, coming up with ideas that are going to make sense, and then talk to our members about and be able to implement as soon as we win the next time around. Similarly, with cutting red tape and regulations, all of the things that are strangling small businesses and preventing them from being successful and expanding in the way they want to, we need to get all of you, both business owners, in a room, talk about what are the most important issues that you're facing, what are the biggest impediments to you growing your business. I suspect probably this pension plan coming forward, the carbon tax, the energy policies and so on are significant, but there's lots of others. There's thousands and thousands of regulations that don't make sense. So again, we need to be able to hit the ground running. We don't have any time to lose. Ontario is in dire economic straits, and we're the only party that's going to be able to turn that around.
Thank you, Heather, and thank you everyone for coming here to take an interest in the rebuild of our party. We have 6 weeks left of this leadership, and it's a big decision we need to make. Whether it's the same old approach, whether we want a reset, whether we want to rebuild the party based on the principles of our grassroots. I can tell you I will work 7 a.m. to 12 each day over the next 3 years to make sure we're in a position to win. I will go to every corner of this province, I will reach out to people from every walk of life, from every part of Ontario, to build a PC party that can connect, to build a PC party that has relationships. And I really believe, my heart of hearts, if we do that, we can win everywhere. If you're interested in getting involved in my campaign, we've got lots of great local supporters here, whether it is Councillor Rick Johnson, the Pickering Councillor Steve Yamada, chairing our campaign in Whitby, or whether it's the Gilchrist family. I think there's about 14 of them here today who long roots in the area, or Aaron Hopkins, of course, in Durham. I think there is some important lessons we've learned in this leadership. Lessons that the party membership wants their party back. That it can't be a top-down party. It can't be policy out of left field mid-campaign. We will build the party that you drive. We will, as Monty said, have a policy platform out early that is a reflection of your voice. We will make sure there's no part of the province that is left void again, where the party didn't show up. And I promise you, I will not sleep until we achieve that goal. And I believe there is no shortcuts in life. My grandfather worked till he was 94, and he always told me, he said, there are no shortcuts. This is going to be a marathon of work. One thing I've learned during this leadership is this is a gigantic promise. And it takes time, it takes endless energy and work ethic. And I promise you, I'm up for that challenge. I will listen to you, value your opinion, and I will make sure that we get it right.
You know, I got involved in this really because I really concerned about our children's and our grandchildren's future. I worry about what's going to happen with my three sons. Are they going to be able to find meaningful employment here in Ontario? Are they going to have to go somewhere else? I don't want that to happen, and I know you don't either. I worry about your children and your grandchildren too. We need to make Ontario a place that they can be proud to live in and that they can make a good living. And I really believe that I have the skills and experience to turn Ontario around and make it the economic powerhouse that it once was and can be again. You know, I've had experience in the private sector over many years. I've worked for one of Canada's largest banks. So I certainly understand, and from an international perspective, where Canada sits in the economic perspective picture and Ontario's place within. But I've also practiced law for over 25 years, and that is an important perspective, I think, to bring to the table. Because I'm doing my job as an MPP and as leader of the party, a potential premier, very much in the same way that I did when I was practicing law. People used to come to me for solutions. They didn't want to hear ideas. They didn't want to hear airy-fairy things. They came to me for solutions, and that's how I got paid. I am a problem solver. That's what I do. And that's the business that I would want to do as your leader. That's what I've tried to do as an MPP, because it's very much the same situation. You as members and as taxpayers of Ontario pay for me to solve problems. That's why I think people elect politicians, is to solve the problems that people are facing. And I would pledge to you that I would do everything in my power to continue that, to work for all of you here, for the four ridings that are represented, but the whole people across Ontario. And finally, I believe that I've had the volunteer experience, which had got me into politics in the first place. Having been involved for about 10 years on the Grandview Children's Foundation, Durham Mental Health Association for 18 years, I really know a lot of the real problems that people are facing in Ontario. And I believe through my work as an MPP, working on two select committees as well, I've got some solutions that are really going to make a difference for people. So that's my pledge to you. We need to bring back government in 2018. And for those of you who have already pledged your support to me, I'm very, very grateful to you for that. For those of you who are still considering it, I would ask that you come join us. Come join our team, because together we're going to win back Ontario in 2018.
Thank you, first and foremost, for coming here tonight. This is great to see a room full of conservatives, proud conservatives, working to rebuild the party. I've said clearly that regardless of who wins this leadership, I'll be around to help rebuild the party, because Ontario does need a conservative party to win power in 2018. I've tried to be clear throughout this leadership campaign and tonight that I'm running because we don't need a second Liberal Party in Ontario. And I don't want to see our party swing to the left to be like Kathleen Wynne in the Liberals. I think that would be a devastating mistake for our party electorally. Most importantly, it would be a mistake for Ontario. We have to be the party that stands up for taxpayers, to get government under control, to get government living within its means. We have to be the party that stands for ratepayers, to get hydro bills down, to stop the subsidies to wind and solar. And thirdly, we can't be afraid to stand up for families and for conservative values and to be on the side of parents in this education debate that's happening. I think these are three principles that we need to have as a party, and I'm trying to bring that voice to that debate in this leadership. Thank you all very, very much for coming. I look forward to the future together. We will win in 2018 if we stand together and are united after May 9th. Thank you.
Four ridings and the individuals that made this event happen.
And we just want to thank Troy Stevens from Northumberland. As a matter of being with us tonight. We have to try and stay, but still fall.